present the news quiz. And here's the chairman, Barry Norman.
Thank you very much. Hello and welcome once again to the news quiz. And before we start, here's my candidate for the headline of the week. It concerns that test tube baby. And it was spotted, appropriately enough, in a newspaper seen over someone's shoulder in the tube by Mrs. Thecla Brakes. The headline at the top of the page read, "I'm going to have my baby." And underneath came the subheading, "The men who made the breakthrough." Well, now, let's meet the panel, who are three of our regulars, Clive James, Angela Rippon and Alan Corran, and tonight's newcomer, the Guardian diarist, Peter Hillmore. And so we move rapidly into the first round, which once again is about politics. Clive James, who in politics is not fit to hold or even aspire to political leadership, and why does he want to get rid of the old blunderbuss?
Now, I don't know why it has to be me first with a question like this. I had an all-purpose answer ready for every question, and the answer being Diddy David Hamilton, the disc jockey, who is not going to marry the girl he didn't marry and is now not going to marry some other girl. But that doesn't fit this question, does it?
No, but if you told me earlier, I'd have got a question that did fit.
Not fit. Now, I sort of recognise this. Can I have a few seconds to think?
No,
I can't, can I? No. Can I throw it open to someone else while I think?
Yes, throw it open to someone else while you think. Angela.
Yes, well, I know that it was said in the House of Commons, and it was said, I think, about somebody like Mr. Rees. Was it?
Yes, it was.
It was said about Mr. Rees. I'm just wildly trying to think which thing he did this week that somebody thought wasn't fit.
Well, it is so much better an answer than Clive James's that I'll give you the 2 points anyway. The answer...
Oh, I know what it was. It was over the Law and Order Act, wasn't it?
It was.
Yes.
Yes, you deserve
it. An Information Act instead of a Secrets Act. That's right.
Just to make it all perfectly clear, it was indeed Mr. Merlin Rees, the Home Secretary, was told he was unfit to be a political leader by Labour MP Geoffrey Rooker, and this came during a heated debate in the Commons on the government's white paper proposals to replace Section 2 of the Official Secrets Act, which is known as the old blunderbuss, with a new Official Information Act dubbed the Armalite Rifle by Mr. Rees. But that's two very good points to Angela. And Peter Hillmore, who is being talked about here?
After 50 minutes non-stop talking and nobody could stop her, she'd reduced her examination board to three little boys from a not very well-informed school.
Can I say David Hamilton? No, David Hamilton's girlfriend.
No, not even David Hamilton's girlfriend.
I wonder if I can recoup my loss by suggesting that I might even know who this is. It's a wild stab.
Well, it would make a nice change for you to get an answer right, Clive, so please try.
I think it's Margaret Thatcher talking to the press.
It isn't. Yes, it was. It was the bionic woman herself, Margaret Thatcher, described being interviewed on Panorama by Robin Day, Robert McKenzie and Fred Emery of The Times, and that description came from the biro of Jean Rooke in The Express. 2 points to Clive James. Angela Rippon, who are the thieves, rogues and robbers whose descendants stole £9 million from the post office? And who wasn't allowed to sit when he said where they were sitting?
Is it anything to do with making telephone calls?
Not to my knowledge, no.
No, then I don't know.
But Alan Corran does.
Well, I'm not sure. Is it that wild shriek from Mr. Cavan, who was chucked out of the House of Commons for going on about all the people who were... who down the years, all the lords who down the years, including Lord Thornycroft, whom I'm not supposed to mention because he was chucked out of the House of Commons under privilege, but I enjoy no such privilege here.
There's a lot of people in the audience shaking their heads here.
You wouldn't like to get the man's name right.
It's the only time I've ever heard his name mentioned. I don't know what he's been doing since he was elected, but it's it's Cavan or Cavanan.
I do know what you mean, Alan. Yes, his name is Mr. Dennis Canavan. And he made these remarks about members of the House of Lords, who he said were descended, from thieves, rogues and robbers. And Mr. Canavan is the Labour MP for West Stirlingshire, and he said all this during a debate on the Scotland Act on Wednesday. And Peers' ancestors, he said, stole Scottish land, and Lord Thornycroft, he said, was chairman of Pirelli, which was one of the companies, which he alleged made £9 million out of overcharging the post office. Mr. Canavan was told to withdraw from the chamber when he refused to retract his remarks. I think I'd better give you 2 marks there, Alan.
Lord Thornycroft in rubber goods scandal. I didn't know he was associated with Pirelli before.
who summarised, Alan, his political views in Parliament like this.
Police ought to be totally prevented from ever molesting young people at all, from ever putting them into jails and raping them and putting them into brothels. Women's lib would be realised by girls being given a house of their own by the age of 12, and three-quarters of the wealth of the state being given to girls so that marriage would be abolished and the girl could have as many husbands as she liked.
Amazingly, this is not a speech by the son of the man who wrote Scourge of the Swastika. This is the other Lord Russell, son of Bertrand Russell, who in the House of Lords made what was marvellously and delicately described in the Times as a disjointed speech. Although exactly why it was disjointed, they didn't go on to explain. And he was advocating all that stuff, which made the noble lord sit up and worry less about Lord Thornycroft.
Quite so. It was Earl Russell, and he went on to say,
Mr. Brezhnev and Mr. Carter are basically the same person.
Must have been a hell of a night in the Lords. Well, he was then told he'd been speaking too long, whereupon he left the House without another word. And to end this round on politics, where better to turn but straight back to the belted up Earl again, in this brief biography from the Daily Telegraph.
Educated at Dartington Hall, Russell, 57, is the author of a slim volume. Besides writing, he also crochets. A few years ago, he complained to a visitor that a pair of trousers he'd crocheted out of string had taken a long time to make. I don't have a pattern, he explained. I had to keep trying them on.
Well, he would, wouldn't he? If he didn't have a pattern, he would. Anyway, at the end of that round, the scores are as follows. Peter Hillmore has yet to register. Clive James and Angela Rippon have 2 each, and Alan Corrin is ahead with 4. And we come now to our melodic round, in which, as usual, each question is vaguely associated with a piece of music. And first, for you, Clive James, here's a sample.
Keep the home fires burning while your hearts are yearning, though the boys are far away, they dream on.
Good God.
No, what I want to know, Clive, I don't want your musical criticism. What I want to know, Clive, is who has been doing just that, i.e. keeping the home fire burning, as it were, in Charlbury?
Now, for some incredible fluke, I know the answer to this.
What has happened to you, Clive?
I don't know.
There's two answers you
I don't know what's gone right, but I actually do know the answer. Do you want to know the answer?
Well, it would be helpful, yes.
Now, the reason I know it is because the current head of British Rail, the man who's head of British Rail this year, has such a memorable name, Peter Parker. He's the man who picked a peck of pickled pepper. And Sir Peter Parker has stepped in personally to ensure that the log fire in the station at Charlbury would be preserved and not changed to an electric one, because a lot of MPs live in Charlbury. And the moral here is, if you want something preserved in your village or town, make sure that a lot of MPs live there. And if they don't live there, you haven't got a dog's chance in hell.
But he kept the coal fire burning at the railway station with some assistance from a gallant band of protesting commuters known as HOOF, which, as you may have guessed, stands for
Hands Off Our Fire.
They could just make my train run on time for a start. It wouldn't be bad. Peter Hillmore, a song for you.
Run, rabbit, run, rabbit, run, run, run. Run, rabbit, run, rabbit, run, run, run. Bang, 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 bang goes the farmer's gun. Run, rabbit, run, rabbit, run, run, run.
Oh, forget it now.
No musical criticism, Clive? No? Peter Hillmore, the question is, as of last week, how long have the rabbits been running in London?
It's not the answer you gave me.
It's not the item I was thinking.
You must be very naive to think that Clive would give you a real answer if he could put it out himself.
It seemed plausible. I thought it was the man who was imitating the rabbits in the field when the man with the shotgun thought he was a rabbit and fired at him.
No, we don't have nasty questions like that on this programme.
In London?
Yes.
It was the grand reunion for the Playboy Bunnies that a man, I think Victor Lowndes, had a party for all these girls who had funny things on their heads and went around presumably not imitating rabbits.
I don't think they're allowed to under their contracts. Do you happen to know how long they've been running?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.